At this moment, we are living in our past, feeling the present, and looking at our future, all at the same time. In this present world of discontentment and haste, people have chosen to sell their dreams for a man-made wealth called money. We're living in a time where everything has a price tag. Yet, the natural wealth has lost the meaning like never before in the history of mankind. In this dynamics of humanity and dance of life, there exist people lost in time, who are reflection of our own history and have remained unchanged since ages close to 60,000 years. This is the story of a civilization lost in oblivion, a civilization that may not see the end of this century. Let's have a final look at our own past before it vanishes. Let's behold the last tribe. It's been about 70 years since India gained its independence. Being a democracy, freedom was guaranteed to everyone. In fact, our population explosion has given freedom of expression a new meaning. Since independence, we have grown 4 times to over 1.3 billion. The people need to be convinced first in a system where the ultimate power lies with the voters. Perhaps no one wants to touch this unpopular discussion. Because of this massive population pressure, every year vast spans of primary forests are modified to suit the human desires. A big population may be seen as an asset, but only when we have the required means to respect the aspirations of everyone. As a result of this resource disparity, we are ultimately having a huge rich-poor divide, which is only widening every day. When India stands third in the list of number of billionaires, it also harbors approximately a quarter of the world's poor population. This ever-growing divide and disconnect is leading to the struggle between the classes. And the Naxalite movement is a reflection of it. In the summers of 2014, Naxalite situation in southern Odisha was tense, as my BSF unit was shifted from the border to anti-Naxal operations in Koraput-Malkangiri area. For me, Operation Green Hunt had a dual meaning, one as a military officer and another as a wildlife biologist. My deployment was the infamous Red Zone of southeastern Odisha, forming a part of Eastern Ghats, a land they called Naxalite area, but the wildlifer within me preferred to call heaven. The metal road used to end here, and the onward journey was possible only on foot. The distance was not judged by kilometers, but the time required in reaching. It was the tri-junction of the three states, Odisha, Chhattisgarh, and Andhra Pradesh. Despite the operational hazards, I was seeing the threat as an opportunity to explore the untrodden paths. Within 1 kilometer of my base camp was the Machkund Power Project. Established before independence, it was the power sharing agreement between Andhra and Odisha. In addition to the hydropower, the project provides ideal habitat and isolation for a few leopards who call it home. Perhaps wildlife don't actually need our supervision or management. It just requires our absence. The undulating landscape covered in thick green carpet. The meandering river valleys. The beauty of this land not only lies in the natural harmonies, but also in the untold mysteries it hides within. It was a protected area created not by decree, but by circumstances. In fact, being a red zone, nothing was known about the wildlife of this area. The region has remained unexplored due to the inaccessibility and the political instability that has continued for the past few decades. Perhaps this was the only part in India where even the national flag was not hosted during Independence Day until recently. Cashew plantations on the hillside and the coffee plantation in the shady valleys were a common sight. In an area considered economically backward, these plantations were considered a way of economic upliftment of the region, which is perhaps a strategy in developing the tribal belt living below poverty line. Along with the fruit, the fleshy receptacle of the cashew was also utilized to make local country-made wine, which was then used for home consumption and selling in the market at 10 rupees a cup. During operations, camera equipments were never my priority. Most of the time, I used my pocket smartphone to shoot things and just to get a quick shot while moving. I was fighting the war and studying the nature at the same time. While moving in the forest, we have to remain focused all the time. Slightest mistake could be disastrous. During anti-Naxal operations in the interiors, many times I encountered tribal groups making liquor along the freshwater channels, resembling somewhat like Naxal campsite, one of the many situations that used to test our decision making. Any error in judgment could lead to the collateral damage that we could never afford. My base camp at Ankadeli had a hilly terrain all round. It was a previous Naxal stronghold and a point of motivational meetings of Naxals before the forces got deployed here. The degree of their influence is depicted by the Naxal memorial in Hanumal village, built in the remembrance of their slain leaders, and also included name of the Naxal leaders killed in other states of India. This region is basically a tribal belt dominated by Gadba, Kandha, and Bondas, having their own distinctive cultures. The Ankadeli market has huge rush on Thursdays. It was a day of the local tribes to sell their goods, and also a day for the foreigners to see these tribes firsthand. Apart from all the tribes in this region, the Bonda tribe caught my attention in particular. This primitive tribe inhabits the remote highlands in the eastern ghats of southern Odisha. The inaccessibility of this area has not only allowed this tribe to continue their ancestral ways, but also have given fertile grounds for the Naxalite movement to flourish. The Bondas have been living completely disconnected with the mainstream since eternities. Living away from the civilization, the only time people get to see these hill Bondas is when they come out in the weekly markets to sell their forest produce. Walking for hours in the hills from their village in Andral and then going back before sunset. But there were two more Bonda villages further ahead of Andral that have chosen to remain silent in their hilly abodes. Unlike the Bondas of Andral, they neither speak or understand Odia or any Dravidian language. In fact, their language has links with Afro-Asiatic language family. The Bondas in this region are entirely dependent on nature and believes in the subsistence on the forest itself. These two Bonda villages, Dumripada and Badvel, were located ahead of the usual Naxal routes, way beyond our area of domination, and were never reached by the security forces. These were the last two villages that have preserved their original primitive lifestyle. It was perhaps an ultimate opportunity to see the prehistoric values and experience the ancient customs of India. A rare prospect to understand a civilization that is untouched from various revolutions, and also to know if Naxals have any influence on their existence. I then started preparing for this big operation. The route towards the Bonda Valley runs northwest of River Machkund, amidst steep valleys and thick forests. Rising about 3,000 feet above sea level, this was a wild and picturesque territory, rich in flora and fauna. The terrain was challenging, yet spellbounding at the same time. The forests were thick and filled with huge climbers. The inviolate space provided by the primary forest has allowed the giants of the animal kingdom to thrive here, giving refuge to the largest moth species in the world, the Atlas moth. The enormous black emperor scorpion could be seen everywhere, sometimes even found in our shoes. The Malabar giant squirrel was frequently observed in the forest canopies, showing a continuous distribution along the river valley, which I later realized was in fact connecting two larger populations of Malabar giant squirrels. The people in this region practice sustainable fishing. After receiving the catch, they release the smaller fish back in the water and just catch the bigger ones. This allows the fish to attain huge sizes, like this 25 kg fish, which was seen being carried by two villagers to the weekly market in Ankadeli. It was truly the land of the giants. In these forests, one cannot afford to let the guard down and have to be watchful for any minor sign or unnatural modification in the environment. for it could be IEDs, traps, or ambush. You're constantly analyzing the terrain while moving in the forest. Spotting wildlife comes naturally when you're walking in such a watchful way. The head marking of this trinket snake was quite peculiar and made me record its identifying features. After taking some close shots and noting the morphological characters, I left the snake in its habitat. Later, after referring to various literatures, I could not find any exact description of this snake. And how could I?
It was a new subspecies of trinket,
described later that year. Such was the uniqueness of this habitat. Moving in the valley about 4 kilometers from my base camp, this hardworking creature caught my eyes. I quickly grabbed my mobile and started recording. As one of my guards shouted, this deer barely gave me a few seconds. Luckily, my mobile was on shooting mode already. It was a Chausinga, the four-horned antelope, a species difficult to spot even in the well-protected tiger reserves of India. During my deployment period, I had multiple sightings and signs of Chausinga around Odisha-Andhra border. Despite hunting pressures, this rare species was found thriving in the Naxalite area. Their distribution seems to run parallel to the Machkund River, away from all the human habitations. Many of the villagers were also seen keeping the fawns of the barking deer as pets, or perhaps just waiting for it to grow in size. We thank the dung beetle and move ahead. It was a long journey through a diverse terrain. The virgin forest was nourishing the wildlife biologist within me, allowing me to understand the dynamics of life in a war zone. I used to get the wildlife cues from direct sightings, sign surveys, roadkills, and also the hunted animals. The Bonda men derive their identity from their arms, bows and arrows. Moving up in the valley, we met a group of men who shared their bear encounter with us. They said they shot him an arrow and the bear ran away in the valley. And now they were going down to search for it. I was amazed to see the audacity of the group. Sloth bear was seen as a conflict animal in this region and was responsible for serious injuries and fatalities across the state. India as a country has lived very closely to the nature and has always been in awe of the forces of it, to the level of worshipping Mother Nature and its creations like God. A reason for our relative tolerance towards wildlife. Perhaps we would be learning something from these hill bondas who were custodians of this ancient beliefs. Monsoon in this region were continuous and unpredictable. The weather can flip in a very short time. Moving across, one keeps getting wet and dry in a cyclic way. It was raining heavily that night, and we had to stay in the forest itself. We woke up early next day in the glorious morning and started our move after the morning tea. It was our second day of the trek. On the way, we met a familiar face. She was the same Bonda lady we encountered making liquor in the valley couple of months back. I know we all looked similar in the uniform, but I was hoping that she might recognize us. She was from the Andral village and spoke Bonda language. Still, I thought that our Odia soldier could have some meaningful conversation with her. Being handicapped in the Bonda language, our interaction went on expected lines. But all I could make out was that change is surely percolating down in the Bonda society. In these depths of the forest, no journalist has ever entered, and whatever I'll record would have an archival value to understand this ancient community. While crossing Andral and moving towards our ultimate goal of reaching Dumripada and Badvel, I was thinking that how we will speak to them. None of us knew the Bonda language, and the Bondas, they neither knew Odia or Hindi. The Bondas here are known for their fiercely independent spirit. They address themselves as Remo. Of all the 32 villages of Bonda tribe, these two villages were the most remotely located. After 2 days of walking, the villages were finally within sight. But the initial move was crucial. I would hate to surprise them. It was always a good idea to meet the village elders first. But the big question was, how do we communicate? We started off with the universal language that we all understand, the language of love. Gradually, we started gaining their trust, but neither of us could have a verbal exchange. It was more like a Russian talking to a Chinese. Despite being a few in numbers, this tribe has successfully retained the distinctive features of its culture, mainly due to the geographical isolation and more perhaps due to its independent spirit. The Bondas have a unique way of dressing up. Clean shaven head decorated with headbands of Palmyra stripes and plaited fillets of Caryota fibers stands out in sharp contrast with other tribal groups, where women have long hairs arranged in buns. The neck covered with multiple aluminium rings called khagla and a mass of colored bead necklaces around the neck. The bangles were made of brass, covering the whole of the lower arm. In addition, the Bondas wear brass earrings called limbi, a short and narrow stripe of loincloth called ringa was weaved at home. These ornaments perhaps have a function of protecting them from the injuries and attacks by the wild animals. Among the tiled roof, I noticed a cemented house. My curiosity took me to Simon. He was the odd one. After interaction, I came to know that he originally hails from Kerala and have been working here for an NGO, living in this village for last 4 years with his family. He was a link between the government schemes and the Bondas, and also manage a small school for the Bonda tribes. And the biggest factor was that he was someone who understands their culture and knew their language and had the confidence of the tribe. He was my window to the Bondas' way of life.
We have to make a 3 category. It's older generation, 0 literacy rate. Adults, we can say 20%. Then youngsters like youth, 9 to 14 age. They are in Dumripada, so we can say 100%.
Simon managed to convince the village elders for an interview. I could not have asked for more. In the era of 4G, these two Bonda villages have no television or mobile with them. I was curious to know about their knowledge of the other world and was wondering what their demands would be. While interacting, I was keeping a constant vigil on the surrounding, holding my rifle and operating the camera simultaneously.
Actually, we joined in 2010 as a family. Government started a lot of this hostels for the children to bring them up in the higher education level. Income generating programs like mango plantation, cashew plantation.
Okay.
Other activities, government is doing.
Okay.
To bring them in a mainstream level. Last 5 years, I never met any Naxal people, but I heard some of the issues from other side of this area, like Patraput, Sindiguda, Kalguda, and all. But I never heard about any news from our village. Pena Mapru. Nena Bondale Mui Mapru Dukuntukara. Nen Bujarile, my mama, Webukunda, Kunda, Kunda, Mayosundo. Kena Ambona, Mapru Nepujadam Tune. Ne Gime Setinekara. Using Ambona, Mapru, Mapru Nimi, Mama Taki.
Sa khali deo dukupulesa ani hiyo budi giasu
sagutun pulei akena sa demo kuni akena sa gutun karma kurung ring ase sepo se ga demo kuni kena sa gutun gorbu e horizon le aikena bero na aikena bero na rona korle kherong bero kuni gutun sami kherong ridar bero na rona ane aikena bero na kenang ba su tabro suk su se ga tu kuni mara na khali deo ane isa obdi gya su bro se ga kendalu kuni ta gulayu ken tu na kende mo na gulayu ken ade mo na ikini remo su sundor kuna kali maya na kenang se gubule kenang ger se lale ana dress ol gur burga sari ol burga sa na ken asa mai tu kule mo na ra sa na mai yong ina tu kunung sa যদি আমি ইয়ং আগুই গাড়ো না আমি এসা আমায় না বরেলে বিবে দুটা কেন বিবে দুটা যদি এন্তুক দে তো এন্তুক মাইন বক রাইসাম বাবু মাই আনা গুবলে আতুক তাসে এসা কেনা মুই না এ না পে ইংলিশ আমার পে সোনা সোনা সুকু কেনা বুং বুং দুটা কেন স্যার
প্রশ্ন দুটা পে আনা ওলুক তো পে ইংগের সেলালে আ ওলুক তো চা আপে మా పే శ్రద్ధకి మాడేము తప్పైనా ముందు তারপরে বুদ্ধি সুলোই তুর থাকে আপে মা ডেঙ্গুতা আনা মুই বুবু নেনা ও গাইনা ডিকেন ডেং না নে ওবুদি ডিকেন ডিকেন ডেং দা কেরা
আমার বুবু মা নে মারো না দাউ বেলাও কেরা সা দাউ বেলাও
সো when we came here no that mother used to wear this kind of things but she totally changed
but now she is not wearing
that
on mother is that metal thing
on okay. mother is standing there no
did she stop completely or like
she removed her
okay okay why so anything specific
so she went to the medical
for okay okay right? okay
that day she removed then she didn't
okay
pe naina bharat desh na pradhanmantri jado se waqt pe modi ji do se munda imir ta amai samad tu pe ape pe ana mama ఓయింతు పేయి నేను ప్రధానమంత్రి ఎలా బుర దుతున్ నోన పే ఆన సుసు గొంతు పే
మై గులోమి ఫోటో కేనా డెమో సేగా ఉయిసే గోసి తోదే
గోసి తోదే
మామా దర్కర్ మాడో సేకి మామా సుంతు పే కిరో
పే సుంతు పేయి
సుంబే
అకి పే ఉయి కాలి డామో కే గురోన కాదామో గంగుర్ మారి సతో
তারপরে
Finally, we could manage a fruitful interaction with them and gain some insights of their culture. It was reassuring to know that the Naxals have no direct impact on these two villages and the Bonda tribes. The demands of the tribe was not luxury, but bare necessities. The channels in the valley were full of flowing water with freshly sown paddy. Their primary food. For the requirements of meat, they eat chicken, goats, and even cows. Every part, including the intestine, were cleaned and consumed, and the hide was left to dry up. The Bondas are expert hunters. Hunting in the groups, they sometimes light the hills on fire to flush out the animals. Fire was also used to clean up the forest for new plantations. Wild pigs, chausingas or barking deers. No animal can escape those pointed arrows.
Kitna teer mara inhone?
Kitna teer mara?
Gotta teer mara thila je kukur thila ame gotta teer aaj mara thila.
Mara kitna chakta? Chaar teer mara?
After the hunt, they perform rituals for appeasement of the forest gods in their own way. The tribal society was matriarchal. The dominance of women was also reflected in the marital norms of the community. The Bonda girls largely marry boys who are at least 5 to 10 years younger than them. The girls look after their husband as he grows up, and in turn he cares for his older wife. Unlike most other populations of India, the sex ratio in Bonda community is tilted towards the women. The women are the primary workers and providers of food for the community. Bondas in general love their wine, which is made by cashew receptacle or rice. The practice of wine making is a labor-intensive job and is led by the women folks, like most other difficult jobs. While returning back to the base camp, we decided to have some interaction with the winemaking group in Andral. Luckily, one of the young lady could speak Odia.
ये पिंड जी तमे के भी ना
हमें पिंड बने सर
काई
की आज कल समस्त एंती साड़ी पिंडला ड्रेस पिंडला हमें पिंड बने
तो पिला माने पिंड को ना जी
ताकर बोले कल जो पिला माने पिंड बने
आज पिंड ना
It is clear that the new generation is getting in touch with the modern world and is not likely to wear the Bonda attire or continue with the Bonda tradition. At the turn of this century, these long surviving cultures and those metal rings may not be visible anymore. The Remo language is now an endangered tongue as more Bondas like this in Andral are gradually shifting towards Odia as their primary language of communication. The absence of a script for the Remo adds to the threat of its extinction. Like the evolution of species, human evolution is also inevitable. The success of any community depends on how sustainably it utilizes the common resources. Perhaps that is the reason why this tribe has survived for that long. Maybe the world can draw this leaf out of the Bonda's book before it finally closes. The time spent in the Naxalite area gave me a glimpse of how our past would have been when the groundwater was plentiful, rainfall was good, when air quality was not an issue, when summers were not as hot, and we could enjoy a little greenery around us. The health of biodiversity is key to the overall well-being of our own species as well. Our success as a species is also its downfall. With our growing population and differential access to resources, this rich-poor divide will continue to grow, giving rise to the internal unrest and civil wars. Perhaps we could answer this problem with economic development. But the big question is, are we actually gaining anything by impoverishing nature? isn't it one step forward and two step back? We are happily clearing the primary forest, evolved since eons, replacing the original forest with the man-made ones. A holistic development is only possible when we account for the vital ecological services of nature, a priceless commodity we have ceased to value. Maybe after reaching their developed status, these Eastern Ghat hills would be replaced with something like the garbage ghats already emerging on the boundaries of Delhi. We may end up inventing a few new diseases and pay for our medical treatment with the money we have earned with our so-called development. It's high time the humanity signs an MOU with the environment as well, before it's too late. In a land where people cannot differentiate between soldiers and Naxals, a land where even the concept of a country does not exist, the idea of wildlife protection is difficult to propagate. But I still believe that the ecosystem and wildlife of this area will remain healthy until the human intervention overpowers the natural balance. The life surviving in this unique war zone has defined survival of the fittest in real terms. Perhaps no single species has ever caused such profound changes to the environment like us. No wonder that these primary forests are still found only in the battle zones, like this in Odisha, where safety and access are an issue. Maybe it's time to have our own customized development goals that are in sync with our historical values and ethos, and do not believe in development at the cost of nature. Mother Nature has survived as molten magma. She is neither fragile, nor she is gasping for air. In fact, this misnomer applies more to the humans that may not survive the environmental changes beyond a certain point. It is not our environment that needs us, rather, it's the other way around. At this rate of human-induced evolution, the Homo sapiens could itself become the last tribe.